My name is George, and I'm from the 1984 Loyola batch. 84, it seems like a long time ago. A hardcore Loyolite from LKG all the way to the 10th. Those days we didn't have plus two at Loyola. You know, the school gave me a foundational confidence that goes way beyond the walls of academics. You know, it starts with a cocky sense of self-worth or self-confidence. That certainly didn't come from scoring high marks, but with an environment of overall development and a can-do attitude that mostly came from my activities on Loyola's stage or on the basketball court. And those activities I continue to this day. I've been in the IT industry now for 30 years. Most of my career opportunities were defined by luck, hard work, but most importantly, an attitude of getting outside my comfort zone and starting afresh every few years. My corporate career of 20 years went across Japan and Australia, working for IBM, Hitachi, and Infosys. And in 2012, I started my entrepreneurial journey by starting a software company in the enterprise cloud computing space. And over the next 7 years, we became a Salesforce Platinum partner with about 160 people. Recently, I sold the company to an American corporation. That's where I am now, enjoying consulting gigs, board memberships, and a variety of hobbies that include magic, Ottandulal, yoga, art of living, horse riding, motorcycling a country every year, and running half marathons. Once again, I'm getting into that comfort zone now, and I can feel that sense of cocky Loyola confidence emerge again to go into another exciting journey. That's a little bit about me, and I'm looking forward to meeting all of you at the panel discussion. And one more thing, my friend and classmate, batchmate from school, Vaidyan, wanted me to show you a magic trick. Magic is one of my hobbies. And this trick is all about how I teach you how to make money out of this. So here, you take a 50 rupee note, and then you fold it. You fold it. Watch my hands. I'll make sure my hands don't leave your sight at any point of time, and there is no camera tricks used here. And I fold that 50 rupee note into a fold like that, and then watch very carefully, and I blow it, and I unfold it, and there it goes. It's now a 500 rupee note. Now, the motto of the trick is don't ever make money. Don't ever work for money. It's easy to make. Work for the love of it. To love life through the work you do is to be intimate with life's inmost secret. That was a quote from Khalil Gibran. Thank you.
Shahjan Dasan, I've been a programmer since my seventh grade back in Loyola. And welcome to my office. And this is my home office. I still program, as you can see. I thoroughly enjoy programming. And I had the opportunity to work in a gaming company about 10 years back. And we used to make social games. You might have heard of games like Farmville and City Bill, Poker. There were a lot of games that I worked on. And I hope to talk to you in the Loba Explore series. I live in a Seattle suburb. Seattle is in the northwest corner of the US. It's on the Pacific coast. It's quite beautiful here. It's snowing today, but it's usually quite green and it reminds me of Kerala.
Hi, my name is Sarah. I'm a freelance documentary filmmaker. And in my previous job at the American Museum of Natural History in New York City, I worked on every part of creating media for the museum's exhibits, from drawing storyboards to writing scripts, directing videos, producing, project managing, editing, animation, voiceovers, all the way to installation. It was at the museum that I met Loyola alumni Alex Jacob. We work together on media programs that are part of the museum's permanent hall of ocean life. My top skill is taking a bunch of information and crafting it into an engaging story. For an exhibit on the human brain, I had to explain the structures and functions of the brain through a video that played in sync with a giant brain model. I came up with a story of a high school student auditioning to get into a prestigious dance school and using every part of her brain to control her muscles, access memories, interpret fear, and experience joy during her audition. The dancer's story worked.
She's done it. This has been her best solo performance.
Exhibition media have expanded far beyond video screens to include interactive games, augmented reality, and physical objects that are embedded with technology so that visitors may interact with displays and each other in a third place. That's a concept that everyone is going to chat more about in today's program. A few years ago, I left the museum to do freelance work, and my husband and I, who are both musicians, now live in Asbury Park, New Jersey, a seaside town that has a vibrant music scene. I look forward to chatting with you more about video production, storytelling, and gaming.
I still vividly remember that wintry, stormy afternoon in Pittsburgh, just as they were wheeling my wife into surgery. They made me go through a stack full of documents. What shocked and astounded me was I was supposed to sign on a form choosing between my 9-month pregnant wife and my unborn child in case of unforeseen events during surgery. What a choice, right? Fortunately, it turned out to be the most memorable day of my life for all the right reasons, as after the most tense hour or so ever, I was holding my newborn son in my hands, gazing intently into each other's eyes. You might be wondering why I'm introducing myself to you all this way. It is because this, in a nutshell, defines who I am. So let me try and introduce you to me as a human being, since you probably anyway have a glimpse of my career on the LinkedIn profile. Fortunate enough to have had parents whose core focus was nurturing and educating their children, I was even more blessed by having a father, the late Professor Koshi Vaidyan, himself a pathbreaker, who ensured I was trained and ready to give my first public speech at the age of 5 as a chief guest at my early Montessori school day. He instilled in me the importance of a sound character, integrity, and moral courage. My mother, Mrs. Panama Kurian, who by the way taught at Loyola for a while in the late 70s, not only showed me throughout her life how to be an entrepreneur early on, but also taught me some of the best lessons on her handling adversity with mental strength, stubborn persistence, and grit. Many of my friends know me as a fun-loving, hard-partying, crazy chap who's an endless source of wild stories, laughter, and an inveterate tech and Tesla evangelist taking hair-raising drives from the mountains to the beaches globally. I'm lucky to have plenty of friends around the world, which ensures a veritable feast of experiences, from local cuisines to sailing the sounds of North Carolina to holidays at castles in Scotland and flights in World War II airplanes over Norwegian glaciers. My peers probably perceive me as a successful entrepreneur who gives back to society in many ways, both by volunteering and through philanthropy, where we serve shoulder to shoulder in areas that I'm particularly passionate about, enhancing and removing global barriers to education using technological advances and best practices, introducing robotics to the young'uns, as well as golf and soccer coaching. My employees might, I believe, see me as one of my MBA classmates defined a benevolent dictator, who even so has empowered them and let them work from home and on their schedule as early as 15 years back. But at the same time, has also been a source of inspiration to strive toward constant and continual innovation and improvement. Ultimately, though, what gratifies me most is that I've been lucky in being able to steer my life toward realizing and prioritizing that time is more valuable than money, and in turn, use that precious time toward things that bring me the most happiness and joy. With family here and in India, with friends, especially the ones who in times of need have always been there. And of course, basketball and soccer with my son, golf, tennis, travel, and food. Indeed, I have tried to make my life choices define me rather than my career. And I wish you all the same.
Hello, everybody.
George, you can go ahead.
Hello, everybody. Loyalites and friends from around the world. Wherever you are and whatever be your time zone, warm greetings to all of you. What instead of taking the CAT or GMAT, you got to play a video game? What if your job interview was a game? A game that measured your decision-making capability, your adaptability, your critical thinking, your creativity, perhaps even your emotional quotient. Welcome to the LOBA Explore 7th edition and career guidance session. My name is George from the super amazing 1984 batch, and it's truly my happiness to be the moderator today on behalf of our beloved Loyola. I say super amazing 1984 batch because our batch was the first batch in the history of Loyola to have scored the full class score a distinction. And Father Pulikil had to keep up to his commitment of taking us all for dinner. I've been in the technology industry for 31 years, initially as an employee of IBM, Hitachi, and then for a very long time with Infosys in its early years. And for the last 10 years, I've been an entrepreneur and investor. I would also like to introduce my co-moderators and fellow Loyalites, Mahadev and Devnarayan. Mahadev and Devnarayan, would you like to please tell us a little bit about yourself?
Okay, So I'm Mahadev, and I've been in the school for 13 years. So I'm in the batch of 2021. And I like editing videos and color grading videos, especially in Final Cut and DaVinci Resolve, which is actually a software that's used in Hollywood and stuff. So I guess that's it about me. Dave?
Hey, I'm Dev Narayan PS, also from the batch of 2021. I've been pretty interested in the growth and development of gaming as a medium ever since I learned to grip a mouse and kill Nazis in Wolfenstein 3D. And going through this whole experience has given me yet another perspective into the inner workings of this industry.
Thank you, Dev. You know, when I try advising my 17-year-old daughter on her career choices, I realize it's not easy, as I'm just not very clear myself on what our world will look like 5 years from now. That is when she's ready to get into the workforce. Because in my 3 decades of working, one thing I can tell you is that change is the only constant, and it's exponential and rapid. In that rapidly changing world, the one to succeed will be the ones to go where the future will be. And that's not necessarily where we are today, nor where we were yesterday. Wayne Gretzky, one of the greatest hockey players of all time, said, "You got to skate to where the puck is going to be, not where the puck is." Our topics today is fun and exciting. Games, AR, VR, MR, it's got to be. However, it's serious at the same time, as it is the future in many ways, and for certain holds an amazing array of career opportunities in the fast-changing digital economy. And our panelists are people who have navigated and ridden many such change waves to successfully go to where the world soon followed. It is my deepest pleasure to share stage with our phenomenal panel of Shajan, Vaidyan, and Sarah, and each will introduce themselves when they speak. A few housekeeping rules, it's been put up before, but I'll just quickly announce it. Please send questions for the panelists via the Q&A box. Please make sure your questions are short and to the point. Only questions related to career guidance will be discussed today. Relevant unanswered questions will be replied to via email after the session. So without further ado, let's get into our discussion, and I'll start with Shajan. Shajan, a little bit of trivia about Shajan. You know, Shajan during our school days was our basketball captain. And most interestingly, along with an incredible career he had, he's also taken his athletic interests to the next level. And today, as some of you might have seen in the video, Shajan is a US national powerlifting coach. That's pretty amazing. Shajan, you've had an incredible career working with companies that have transformed the world in their respective domains, be it Microsoft or Twitter. But most topical to us today and seemingly most fun would have been your time at Zynga. Wow. Educate us a bit about this fascinating virtual world of gaming, AR, VR. Shajan, please.
Thank you, Josh, for that generous introduction. Hello from Seattle. I'm very glad to be here today to talk about games, VR and AR. Games, you're all familiar with games. You've played it on your phone. Maybe some of you have a game console at home like Xbox or Nintendo. So that's regular gaming. Now, virtual reality takes gaming to a whole new world where you could buy a virtual reality headset, you can put it on, and you get this 360-degree experience in 3D. And that takes gaming to the next level. So that's virtual reality. Now, augmented reality is something slightly different, where you mix the real world with virtual world. Let's say you have a headset that you can see through. You can see through it just like you're wearing a glasses, and you can see the real world in front of you. And superimposed on that real world, you can put virtual objects in it. So that's augmented reality. Now, in mixed reality, this whole setup is taken like another step further. So you can see the real world, you can have real objects in there and virtual objects mixed with the real world. And you can also interact with the virtual objects. So it's just easier to explain in a video than I can, physically explain it in words. Back to you, Josh.
Thanks, Shajin. It gives us a good base and intro for our topic of the day. Over to you, Vaidyan. A bit of trivia about Vaidyan, I must say, because we are good friends and classmates. During his school days, actually, in present tense, Vaidyan is a Bharatanatyam dancer. And I say in present tense because as recently as our 25th year anniversary, we made him do his steps. Vaidyan, as an entrepreneur, you are in the business of making learning fun and immersive. Oh boy, I wish that this could be transported back to our student years. I might, as a backbencher, I might have learned a thing or two. Tell us how technology and gaming in particular is changing the way people learn today.
Namaskaram all, and thanks, George. That was more of a belly dance at the age of 40. Rather than Bharatanatyam, but still we attempted, persisted, right? George and I have had some hair-raising times together being part of the 1984 batch, and leveraging best practices in technology has always been a passion, incited by the game need for speed during my MBA days, during which same time as well, I created and developed the first application development that I did by bribing a buddy programmer with whiskey. That set a trend for things to come later too. But this interest in technology continued through my various ventures. And currently I am the co-founder and CEO of Atten, a multi-award-winning pioneer in the serious gaming industry. Bridging the global education gap through technology while making learning fun again is a personal mission of mine. Parents, teachers, and even spouses abhor the hours we spend gaming. Can we bring the fun back to learning? Let's take a few examples that we at Atten have created in the serious games and virtual immersive learning field. Binoy?
This is an early augmented reality game where school students learn of red wolf extinction, taking on roles of entomologists, veterinarians, and scientists. Fun, isn't it? This one is a racing game where you have to adjust the cars based on your knowledge of kinetic forces, lateral forces, damping, etc., to win the race.
A trek in the mountains, somewhere in the high Himalayas, goes terribly wrong.
Can you imagine? This was created for JP Morgan Chase executives to play through different levels of assessments to track their potential career path to become a CEO or CFO. How far is that? How about training a teacher by immersing her in different situations and experiences and tracking her decision making? abilities. Or a manufacturing facility virtual walkthrough replicating different rooms of training where they can walk in and take a variety of trainings.
Which keep NFF up and running in a compliant, safe, and efficient manner. Where the tops of the bottles will be cut off so the plasma can be removed.
Or how about a bioreactor training where a wrong move could even cause an explosion, although a virtual one.
Install the sterile sampling device and then make sure it is safe to remove LOTO. Lockout, tag out.
Yes.
The beauty of all
alarms
these virtual worlds
is
that
as soon
you get
as
to
it is recognized.
Simulate real-life scenarios, making it fun, challenging, and exciting through gamification, and at the same time track and assess actual application of knowledge. This is the essence of serious game. Take another example here of a flight simulation.
So here is what exactly happens in this simulation. How this simulation is different from the typical video that you have, for instance, is that this enables people to apply what they have learned. Right? You are making them, you're showing them first what to do, how to do, and then you're making them do it. So you're creating a simulated, immersive environment where they can apply what they have learned. That is what happens here.
Place the engine cowling just below the horizon line, depending on your power setting, for 20 seconds.
Thanks, Binoy. As is often the case with some of these latest and best in technologies, all this got initiated by the Department of Defense here in the US in the late 90s, when they brought out something, a game called America's Army, simply to excite high school students to join the Army. And interestingly, what they found was that kids who went through this game retained a lot more information than others. This, of course, led to a host of research from Harvard to Michigan State, North Carolina State, and Virginia Tech, the latter both of which our company, Atten, had the privilege of being in with the early research. Indeed, as you can see here, the foundations published, the findings published by the National Science Foundation in 2005 is quite amazing and probably intuitive when you think about it. When you read something, you retain only 10% of the information. But when you actually do it, even as a simulation, that goes up to 90%. In fact, with some of our deployments, we have seen phenomenal increases in the performance, accuracy, retention, etc., by the employees, as much as 200 to 300% than before. That's a fun way to learn, right, George?
Yeah, Vaidin. It's very insightful. I think what you're doing will make education as well as training within companies a lot more meaningful in solving real world problems. Good one, Meg. You know, telling a story is one of the greatest skills, one that captures an audience, gets us clients, and makes us friends. Sarah, amongst all your credentials, what shines most is that you're a visual storyteller. For the others, Sarah is also an award-winning film producer. Sarah, we are honored to have you today, and thank you for taking the time. Tell us a bit about yourself and your thoughts on gaming, specifically how its interactivity has transformed applications, particularly in the creative realm of art and entertainment.
George, thanks for that introduction. And my name is Sarah. I'm coming to you from the East Coast of the United States in New Jersey. And I've spent most of my career making media for museums. And I should mention too, I have an India connection. My parents met in India and I started life there, and I had the opportunity to go to Woodstock School in North India for my senior year of high school. So, but back to museums.
Traditionally, museums are places where you go to see priceless objects like this T-Rex on your screen. There's no other place where you can go to see an actual T-Rex. It's interesting, but it's kind of a passive experience. And when I began my career, including video in museum exhibits was considered really innovative. Then exhibit design became more and more interactive, and screen-based interactive exhibits were the next big thing. And then Benoit, if you play this. Now, museums like the American Museum of Natural History are creating unique immersive experiences where you can learn through interactive games, move through a responsive environment, play with other visitors, or play a virtual reality game like T-Rex Skeleton Crew shown here, where visitors work together to build an actual T-Rex and make it come to life. Now, the museum ideal now is what we're going to talk about more, is this idea of a third place where you can experience something that you can't experience anywhere else. Museums want to attract visitors into their buildings through immersive environments and interactive games. And it takes a huge team to do this well, not just game designers, animators, and programmers, but also scientists, educators, exhibit fabricators, project managers, and more. As part of the interactive team, I'd add video components, but my main contribution was really helping to come up with a storyline or craft a game or an experience into a compelling story. And later I'll go into a little bit more detail about a game and the storytelling aspect of it. Now let's hear from Dev.
Thank you, Sarah. Technology has advanced to a point where we can interact with prehistoric creatures right from the comfort of our own living room. With video games now being a valid medium for meeting and interacting with new people, the world is getting smaller than ever. The gaming and virtual world industry is going through an astronomical trajectory of growth. Are we going to increasingly start living in a virtual world with multiple realities, with augmented, virtual, and now mixed reality? What are some of the applications of this technology? Shajan, with your Zynga, Microsoft, and Twitter background, perhaps you can enlighten us about the future that is fast coming at us. Also give us some kind of timelines as to when we can expect this.
Sure, Dave. So mixing the real and virtual world opens up a lot of possibilities. Think about telephones. So you can, you know, pick up your phone and talk to anyone in the world anytime, assuming the other person has a phone. So that was a big revolutionary change from when you had to send a mail, you know, write something, post it, and wait for a response. So telephones are, you know, everywhere now, and video conferencing is getting popular, like, you know, just like what we are doing right now. It's very interactive. You can see, and that opens up a new world of communication. Just like I was explaining virtual reality and then showing you a video, and that video made more sense than me, you know, just speaking about it. Now, bringing the virtual world in, it opens up another new avenue for communication where you can use virtual objects and you can have a group of people communicating using virtual objects and interacting with you with it. Let me give you an example. Imagine a group of doctors, the best in their field, across the globe discussing a case or, you know, maybe using a virtual heart that they can use to explain or communicate to each other what they're talking about. I'll give you another example. Let's say there is an inventor who wants to talk to students just like you, and they're explaining their invention to you using a virtual model of their invention. And this is the most interesting part, where as students, let's say you want to ask a question about a particular piece of the invention, you can open it up virtually and kind of point it the thing and say, hey, how does this thing work? And you know, that just opens up a lot of possibility. We're just getting started. It's going to get better. Back to you, George.
Thank you, Shajan. I wish we were also getting younger. right? So we could see the advancement of a lot of these technologies. I see the potential of mixed reality in so many diverse use cases, you know, and that includes also entertainment, you know, in live shows, like in my own hobby, which is magic. If I'm able to combine different aspects, different other realities into a live show, that should be amazing. And entertainment, gaming, communication, networking, learning, all seem to come together in the advancement of these technologies. Now, I was reading somewhere, video games solely as an entertainment medium makes a significantly larger margin of profit than the music and film industry combined. Why? And where is this coming from? Why then? You bet your entire company fairly on, early on in the field of serious gaming, and video games are now called the third place, as said, I was mentioning. What does this really mean and signify? Tell us a bit about the industry and some of your experiences.
Yes, indeed, George. Looks like I bet really accurately way back in 2005. And indeed, games these days are quickly becoming a third place, as Sarah mentioned. That is essentially a place outside of work and home where people gather, play, interact, or hang out and have fun, limited only by your imagination. In fact, I remember asking my son this winter when he got back from his first semester at college and had made a ton of new friends and very close ones, how he was going to be communicating with them. Would he also be zooming in like we professionals did? And he said, Dada, we are going to be playing video games together, and that's how we communicate. And that is what is happening today, and that also explains this exploding growth in the industry. However, let me backtrack a little bit and explain why serious gaming and virtual immersive learning makes sense, and a little bit of the details into why the research says it is so useful. Thanks, Binoy. Yeah. Could you click on it, please? As you can see here, let me say, all of us watch movies, right? And when we watch a movie, oftentimes, especially with the good ones, we feel like we are part and going along with the hero or heroine. Sometimes we feel angry. Sometimes, you know, in some of the theaters, we even see chapels being thrown. That state of mind is called a state of flow. And what research tells us is if we can immerse users into an environment where we attain the state of flow, then learning itself becomes subliminal. And then we can put them into situations and experiences where they are not only learning by doing, but we can track a whole gamut of data, which gives us the ability to figure out strengths and weaknesses of individuals, just like an individual tennis coach or cricket coach would find out which areas you need to correct and give them that personal instantaneous feedback, which enables them to correct and move forward. Further, we are able to track the decision-making, situational thinking, cross-communications, et cetera, in different environments. And people talk about gamification. Gamification is really prevalent in our everyday lives, from toothbrushes we use to cars we drive, which constantly give us feedback and motivate us to go forward. There are multiple elements to this, but without going into too much detail, let me tell you, research again figures out that the most dopamine kick that people get is when they collaborate together on. Anyway, going into the topic of the growth in this market, you can see here how this virtual world market has been exploding over the years and is going to become a $450 billion market by 2025. So there were some questions ahead before in the Q&A as to whether this would be relevant. And here is your answer. If this industry is growing like this, this needs people, right? And let me show you some examples of salaries in this arena. Recently, a friend of mine and his son were here. He actually was studying neuroscience in one of the prestigious colleges in New Jersey, but then ultimately moved over to learning game development because he enjoyed it. Indeed, he was very happy to hear when I told him that starting salaries here in US can be
you know, from around 100,000 per annum plus. And in fact, it's a very glamorous career too. However, let me also point out that a degree is not an essential requirement here. And as you can see here, there are a plethora of career options, including for musicians, artists, creative folks, all of who don't even need a degree. In fact, most of the people we employ don't have a specific degree in that field. So it could be bachelors of arts, or just people like Dev Narayan and Mahadev, who have messed around with gaming early on. Dev Narayan, you might want to talk a little bit about this later, and Mahadev with creating short videos and video editing. Thank you, over to you.
Wow, incredible growth, and follow the money, isn't it, Vaidya? You know, the market size and growth is astounding. It's like we are witnessing the birth of a black swan, you know? And such black swans act like a wormhole to huge fortunes if we catch it early. And it is early. Above and beyond the fun part that's introduced, does gaming improve the quantum of learning? What are some practical use cases that you've seen, Sarah? And how astounded have you been? Sarah, over to you.
Thanks, George. As Vaidyan said, games are great learning tools, and it's a great way to pack a huge bunch of information into a fun challenge. What you see on the screen right now is a clip from a scientific paper that I had to read when I was working on a team developing an interactive game, Terraforming Mars, for the American Museum of Natural History. And this is just one bit of a research paper. It's in a museum exhibit, we want to accurately explain a process like terraforming Mars, but we don't want to burden visitors with all the minute detail like you can see here. When we worked on developing a game to talk about terraforming Mars, our solution was to entice visitors with a story-like conflict. Mars is a dead, cold planet. It's your job to make it safe for human habitation. Thanks, Benoit. So this is the game, Terraforming Mars, as it was in the final install, and that's our programmer, Cameron, who's standing in to model it. As the clip continues, you'll see the early prototype of a game. And I should mention, at the museum, we were always user testing our games. You want to make sure that visitors get what the game is about, and we're always constantly changing and updating it. So this was our attract loop in an early prototype. And then as it continues, we'll see some of the choice of tools that users had. So this could take up to 3 users in this interactive table. Users had their choice to blow up nuclear bombs, build polluting factories, or even crashing an asteroid into Mars's polar ice caps. That last tool was very effective, but it was actually harder than the other tools to master. And we did not make up these tools. All of the tools came from research from our NASA advisor, Chris McKay. And we introduced actually a progress bar at the top of the table where users could see how they were doing. It was a 3-part game. And as the game progressed, you had 3 levels. First, you had to melt the polar ice caps on Mars to release water. And the second level was to build soil and then grow hardy plants like pine trees to generate oxygen. And this really did a good job of being a game as a third place. We, at the museum, we felt the game really worked when visitors realized that they could get to the next level faster if they cooperated. If one person was good at crashing asteroids, they would work on that, and the other one would work on building factories to release greenhouse gases. So people were collaborating with people they'd never even met before. So the game really worked as what we're talking about today, a third place. And again, why? Like, why would a prestigious museum have a game? Well, because Terraforming Mars, this interactive table, was essentially a quick class in planetary ecology. A lot of basic knowledge was built into this one and really fun game. So now let's hear from Mahadev.
Okay, games have always been a platform to link people with common interests together, be it someone playing Call of Duty or someone playing Arma 3. Sarah's game on terraforming Mars is something unique and exquisite, something that Elon Musk would love to do. Moving on, we have talked about the entertainment part of gaming and how it makes such a tedious and exhaustive process fun and lively. From Farmville to making machine learning algorithms for Twitter, Shajin has always been at the edge of technology. The new possibilities are at its height. That's where new opportunities are being made, and with each opportunity it's filled with enormous possibilities where innovations are being made every second, and with each innovation comes an opportunity for us. I would like to ask the panelists to give their views on these opportunities. Shaji?
Sure, Mahadev. I'm going to walk you through a few slides here. So there is a broad range of opportunities for a career in the gaming industry. So you have creative, there is a wide spectrum of careers in the creative field, all the way from game designers to artists, visual artists. There are technical careers, you know, you have software programmers and QA, quality assurance engineers. They all get to play games, like all of them. And in addition to these, there is also the traditional job functions like HR, finance, you know, all the traditional business functions are there. Next slide, Binay. Now, how do you get started on gaming? You could go take a class online, or you can try creating your own games. When you do this, one of the decisions you need to make is you need to select a gaming engine. A gaming engine is a software package that helps you create games. You can have, you know, there are simple and complex gaming packages. I'd say like start with a simple engine. I'll have more specifics in the next slide. And once you have the game, you need to publish it so that people can see your game and play with it. So there are many places where you can publish your games, like on the web or on game consoles or on the app stores. Binay, next slide, please. And specifically, here's how you get started. If you haven't had a chance to build a game, I'd say like start with courses on Coursera or Udemy. There are a few courses. Let me actually give you a specific course on Coursera. There is one on game design and development with Unity. And on Udemy, there is one where you don't even have to program. There's a course on making an iPhone arcade game. Take a look at it. Now, once you've done the courses, or you know, you can do this even while you're doing the courses, you can take a beginner gaming engine or a gaming game creation experience. I have a few links here. I'll highlight two. There is a gaming beginner gaming engine called Roblox. It's quite popular for games for younger audience, and it's easier to develop. There's also something called Blueprint that creates games in the Unreal Engine. Like Roblox is a very simple gaming engine, but Unreal is quite powerful. But you can start even, it is quite hard to master the Unreal Engine, but you can get started without programming using Blueprint. So once you get to the advanced stage of game development, I can suggest two gaming engines here. One is Unity, and the other one is Unreal. So Unity has very good graphics. You can it's easier to learn than the base Unreal Engine, and Unreal has the most stunning graphics. However, the difference is With Unity, you can learn, you have to use the programming language called C Sharp. With Unreal, the underlying programming language is C++, which is a little bit harder to learn. But if you're into gaming and if you really want, you know, you really want to get the power of all these engines and create great games, I think it's worth your time to invest in learning some of these programming language. But again, like if you're not into programming, you can use those other tools to create games. On the academic side, you don't really have to go through these to get into gaming, but if you prefer the academic path for safety, you can. There is a gaming center coming up in IIT, so you can try that. And any computer science class, any bachelor's or engineering course is going to help you with the programming aspect of it, as well as some of the graphics. And there is also some trade schools that teach you gaming. There is one in Trivandrum, Tunes. That's all I have with this. I hope you get started. Back to you, George.
Thanks, Arjun. Sajan, you've clearly explained in very practical terms the how to get there, which is so very important. And you pretty much, when I look at the Q&A box, many of the questions that they put forward, you have answered just through that session. Thank you very much for that. Back to you, Vaidhan. Vaidhan, I know you, you also said that in the video. I know you're always at the forefront of technology in your personal life too, whether it be the latest gadget that Apple released, and I follow you, or be it one of Elon Musk's latest toys, you're the first one to get it. I have an Oculus that I use to watch movies and play games. And in the Horizon, we now have the, I mean, not the Horizon, I mean, HoloLens is already there. You have the HoloLens. We just heard Facebook talk about Facebook Glass. Then, of course, the rumored Apple Glass coming in the future. Now, is Star Trek becoming real with its holodeck? Tell us, Vaidhan, your view of this fast emerging future world.
Yes, indeed. Augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality worlds are already making huge inroads into the serious gaming industry and into our everyday lives. The following videos will show more about that, but let me also take a step back for a moment. Because there were some questions on what kind of degrees you can do here in US. The earlier slide that I had shown with salaries has quite a few universities listed which give degrees, but let me reiterate this industry specifically. It is not as much the degrees that count, as much as the knowledge you have and the ability you have that you can showcase. An example is me myself. You'd be surprised to know that I've been running technology companies for the last 22 years and been involved with this for close to 30, 35 years. But I can't code to save my life. But then I learned early on, like I said before, that I could buy whiskey and get application development done. So similarly, you don't really need degrees. What you need is the passion to learn and use what you're passionate about. But if you put on those augmented reality examples, this is one where HoloLens is used to look at a Boeing engine. The sound also, please. Pinoy.
And learn about each one in context.
Fuel filter. This component plays an essential role in keeping the fuel clean before it passes through the rest of the systems.
Now remember, with HoloLens, she can still see the real world. So right now she could be talking to a teacher or to other students.
I don't need to be tied to my workspace. HoloLens has no cables, which means that I can learn anywhere and at any scale, and I can choose a size and a position that suits my environment. Let me show you. But not only that, I can access parts that would otherwise be very hard to spot. Show fuel pump.
Fuel pump. This is one of the essential components, which is designed to supply the fuel to the system.
So at this manageable size, an employee can learn in a small space, you know, like at their desk or at home. But in real life, this jet engine is an enormous machine with thousands of components. And it's just as important for employees to understand its true scale.
Show full size.
Full size.
Now I can continue to train at the actual scale.
Fuel nozzles. There are a number of nozzles designed to inject the fuel into the combustion chamber.
Safety is a hugely important part of training with machinery. HoloLens not only allows trainees to negotiate that machinery in.
That's a powerful way to learn, isn't it? Think about use cases in everyday life. Let's take another example here where Dassault uses virtual reality and the trainer is in one location and the trainees are coming on as avatars, but they are working collaboratively. Let's take a look at this.
Instructor, and you are the trainee, you're red today, so if you move your hand as well, wave back, okay, high five, hello. and then you can see that all my movements and yours are tracked by the system. So let's say today I have an instruction, I have a lesson about the wing. I can easily select the underwing panel, and you see that it's a huge part of the aircraft. We cannot remove that in 2 weeks, so we won't do it in a real training session. But here in virtual reality, we can do it. I can remove it, and then you can see all the cables and the pipes inside. And to have a better view, we can climb on top of the wing. I'm gonna bring you with me, and we are on top of the wing together. And I can even select the upper wing panel, and I'm gonna put it to transparent as well. And so you have a complete view of all the pipes and wirings that are going through the wing. And it's a digital mock-up from Katia, so it's called.
Isn't that amazing? You know, just think about it. This is how we are going to collaborate going into the future. And let's take a look at a very recently released Mesh Azure mixed reality.
You are the trainee, you're red today.
Next one, Binoy. Thank you, this one.
Look over here.
It's magical when two people see the same hologram. It's the original idea for why we created HoloLens.
A year ago in Barcelona, you were there to create the first ever shared holographic experience. 200 or so people wearing HoloLenses and seeing holograms all around. As you know, COVID took place, Mobile World Congress was the first to cancel. Now at Ignite, because of COVID, it's not a physical show. We have instead people teleporting in. The entire show is being hosted on Microsoft Mesh, which ushers in this new era of collaborative computing for people to represent self across experiences in a consistent way. The entire keynote is done in mixed reality. Manta rays on stage and fish in front of you. The audience will start contributing their own ideas into this holographic scene as a group that has never been done before. We'll talk about Microsoft Azure, which is why Microsoft Mesh is built on top of, that enables this whole show to take place.
Search area locked.
We'll go through several examples of how mixed reality is changing the face of business. The partnership with OceanX, a ship that is now going to have a holographic lab. Scientists on the boat will be wearing HoloLenses to see what's going on underwater in submarines, to connect with scientists on shore that now will be able to teleport in for the science expeditions that they're working on. A key benefit of mixed reality has always been the ability to represent self across both space and time. I can walk a manufacturing facility with someone even if I'm not there. I can be in an operating room with someone even if I'm not there. So that we can have the same physical feeling of presence, where you can represent yourself from an avatar all the way to a holoportation and collaborate as if you were there.
Yeah, as you can see, pretty much in any field or industry that you are in, whether you're a doctor or engineer, you still have to be familiar with this, or a teacher, right? In fact, I'll give you an example. Dr. Ricardo Pietramon, who was the chair of orthopedics here at Duke University, told me they had, they had implemented the Da Vinci robot to do surgery. I don't know what surgery it was, but some kind of surgery, and the doctors were struggling to use it. However, they brought the doctor's six-year-old son could use it very easily because he was used to all the joystick and things that gamers use, right? And that is the world we are going into. So everybody needs to get familiar with this. Now, George, you mentioned about the Apple Glass. I won't talk too much about that because it's still speculative, but that should be a path changer. Facebook just announced wearables where you can wear it like a watch, you have which gives you haptic feedback. So if you're using a bow and arrow, you can feel that. So it's really interesting worlds that we are going into. And there are plenty of opportunities for budding entrepreneurs, game developers, designers, creative thinkers, artists, etc. And let me reiterate once again, it is what you learn, not particularly math or science or biology that you take that matters. Thanks, George, over to you.
Thanks, Vaidyan. Mind-boggling, truly mind-boggling. It kind of made me pause. You know, it's, I guess the challenge is with so much mixed reality in the mix. Hopefully we don't get all mixed up, what's reality and what's coming from technology. You know, it's so much technology surrounding us and a future engulfing us with all this. You know, are the days gone by where a simple book and a grandmother's tale, will it stop evoking our imagination and creativity? Will all this technology replace the human imagination to dream and our creative abilities? Besides technology, what are the skill sets that will continue to be relevant? Sarah, I think you're the best person to answer this question. Over to you.
Thanks, George. It's true, technology is always changing. And I was looking at the Q&A post and I saw that Sanjay posted a question about just how expensive this equipment is and how quickly the technology gets outdated. That's really true. At the Museum of Natural History, we struggle to afford some of this new technology. We partnered with companies in order to afford augmented reality headsets and virtual reality headsets. But as George was saying, to be successful, there are basic critical skills that don't change and are not expensive. You need good writing skills. You need good speaking skills. You need to be a visionary to see uses for this technology. You need to be good at image making, drawing, photography. And you need to have really good people skills. You need people skills in working with others, knowing your audience and what they want to learn and how they grasp information. So you can work on all these skills now, even if you don't have access to expensive software and hardware. You need writing skills to develop game stories and characters. So listen to your grandmother's stories because that could become a game. But you also need writing skills because you need to sell your ideas. So if you have a great idea and you don't know how to pitch it or write a business proposal, then you're not going to get that far in the industry. In terms of being a visionary, as you go about your daily life, and after this today's panel, think about how games could make life easier. So when Vaidyan was talking about when his wife was giving birth and he had to sit with paperwork, I was thinking like, wow, that could have been like an interactive thing to make it really quick to just log in and not have to write things while you're handling a difficult day. So as you go about your everyday life, think about how games and technology can make things easier. Drawing is another skill. I've found in my career the best animators, the best game designers were also really good at drawing. So that means just being able to freehand draw on paper or paint. So sketches or storyboards
are a quick and easy way to get your ideas across. At the Museum of Natural History, everybody knew how to draw, it seemed like. And, you know, as we were sharing ideas, we always had sketch pads out in our meetings because that was a really quick, easy way to get your ideas across. And it's also really important to master the business side of the industry, your people skills. So don't just focus on the technology. Don't just focus on the creative side. Starting out, I didn't have a lot of interest in business or budgets or accounting. But as my career developed, I had to take on a lot of more of those roles as I became more of a supervisor. And those type of skills are really essential today, like business skills, budgeting, accounting, knowing how to manage people, especially today in our gig economy. So that's it for my ideas of low tech ways to get into this industry. And now let's head back to George.
I agree, Sarah. I think we need to cultivate a multitude of skills, you know, bringing both our left and right brain to take advantage of this huge opportunity that we all spoke about. So we covered the opportunities as well as the different competencies and skills that are required to be relevant and purposeful. And the purpose of life is a purposeful life. In our last segment, I'd like to focus on a very important dimension, which is a broader and deeper question on life, happiness, success, and where work fits into all of that. One of my favorite poets, Khalil Gibran, talked about work as such. When you work, you fulfill. And I love poetry, by the way. I mean, that's a love I carried from school. And Gibran says, when you work, you fulfill that part of Earth's furthest destiny assigned to you when you were born. And in keeping yourself with labor, you are in truth loving life. And to love life through labor is to be intimate with life's inmost secret. Personally, that poetry really resonates very well with me, as work gives me a sense of relevance and purpose. As my mom told me when I was a kid, two decisions in life that you need to take very seriously. One is your career, and the other is who your life partner is. Her logic was very simple. 80% of your waking life, you spend at work. And if you don't enjoy that, you're messing up with 80% of the one life you got. In that sense, the purpose of all education and learning should not be just to get a marketable job, but to find out what your destiny is and what you're here to do. So my simple guideline on this, do what you love to do, or if you're not one of those lucky ones, I wasn't, learn to love what you do. Shajan, please do share with us your wisdom on success as well as learnings and failures.
Sure, George. So success means different things for different people. I'd say like define your own, have your own definition of success. For me, myself, I define success as being able to spend my time the way I please, doing things I enjoy. That's my definition of success. And I think I'm making progress towards that. I like learning and programming. So learning new skills is always something that appeals to me. Like Sarah mentioned, being able to draw, you know, that's a superpower. I don't have it. That's something I like to learn because, you know, you can explain things much better. You can communicate better by, you know, drawing. Students retain more if they actually do things. And I teach. So this is something I need to incorporate into my syllabus to have more hands-on. I need to look into that. And so when you talk about success, I've been programming and I was fortunate enough to get into computer science. I got a degree and then got into the same field. And that was a good part. So when you talk about success, you also need to talk about failure because that gives you that contrast. And I have too many. I'm just trying to pick which one to talk about. Like failure is there. So when I was in Loyola, I wanted to be a pilot. you know, flight planes and things like that. And I got into NCC. I think Wyden was also in NCC. And I wanted to get into the Air Force as an officer, and I took the NDA test. That's how you get into becoming, maybe that's one of the easiest way to get become an officer. And I failed. I failed the test. I got into the interview, then I failed at the interview stage, and I was quite disappointed. I was sad for a few days, and you know, I just moved on. And you know, that's one of the many failures. Now, there was a question on the chat here on how do you convince your parents to support you in playing games? So you need some you need some sales skills, basically. That's not a skill. Maybe you can learn about sales. You know, appeal to your parents' emotions. Don't try logic. Appeal to their emotions, figure out like their weak points, and that's how you make your parents convince your parents that, you know, to allow you to play games. Back to Josh.
Thanks, Rajan. You know, convincing parents. I mean, one of the points you talked about time is struck me when you started speaking, right? I mean, the success is about, you know, freeing up your time. I remember one of my mentors and one of the founders of Infosys, Nandan, him once saying that money can come and go, but time is limited. And if you are able to control that, you would have done very well. Over to you, Wyden. Wyden, you and I came into the workforce with far less choices. And, you know, we're talking about parents with lots of parental influences pushing us in very limited directions. What inspired you to walk that less trodden path to success? And tell us a bit about your failures too. And like Rajan says, I mean, you know, failures actually teach us 10x more than success. So please tell us.
Failures? And me? What are you talking about, mate? Are you serious? No. Seriously, every major pivotal moment in my life has been inspired by failures and the lessons I have learned from them, including the choice of wife. And by the way, even Warren Buffett concurs with your mom on that. You know, to start with, I still remember walking back to our home, dejected, shoulders down, head down. And as I was opening the gate, I could see my dad looking through the window. And as I walked in, he asked me, "How was your speech?" And I said, "That was excellent." So he walked up, hugged, congratulated me. That was a great lesson in parenting for me. Again, I used to be a straight A student throughout, 95 and above, right? All, you know, the SSLC especially, you get that kind of marks. But I was kind of coerced into taking math and science and trying out for the engineering entrance exam. And I think my parents spent quite a bit on coaching lessons as well, which was all utterly wasted because all I did was go and have fun there. And at the end of it, I failed that. And to the extent that one of my close friends' mother started crying and said, "Wyden, what will you do now?" Even my unshakable dad was a little bit shaken. But that drove me to work more diligently toward what then was my aim of getting into MBA. And that pushed me to work harder and smarter going into joining the debating society called UniY there, participating in Rotaract and becoming the president there and running quite a few major projects, which gave real life experience that helped me throughout later as well. So ultimately I ended up topping the MBA entrance exam. Failures often can drive you to major successes. In fact, similarly, when I was hired by a shipping company early on, from MBA, you know, this gentleman was training us to be branch managers that he was planning to open up all across India. But after 6 months of training, we got sick. And being in Madras, we had no choice. We didn't know anybody. However, just like Sarah was mentioning, that is where networking really came into play. We called up old management school alumni all over, literally went from door to door, knocking on unknown companies and walking in and trying to get an appointment with managers to see if we could job, and ultimately ended up getting hired by Maersk Logistics, a very prestigious job, which took me through a really good career path. Again, replete with multiple failures, which drove on to success. In fact, some of these lessons is what also instilled in me the mental strength, persistence, grit, and maybe even that permanent state of restlessness driving me to take the Frostian path not taken that you mentioned. In fact, this is also what led me to spin off our own company around 20 years back, even while the then CEO of this US company offered to start off a spin off another and make me the head of that company. But, Sharjan said earlier, you have to choose your path and your journey, right? And for me, time was the most valuable commodity, and being able to spend the time nurturing my son when he was growing up was more important, as well as I mentioned before, the golf and business travel, which turned into holidays and friends and new experiences. That is the journey I chose. Thanks, George.
Thank you, Vaidyan. In fact, we have an entire session just on life, career, on so on and so forth later this month. So we'll talk more about it. Sarah, before we close, over to you, Sarah. Just tell us a bit about your life story and your learnings.
Okay. I'll jump into when I was in college, I struggled with what to major in, and I kind of vaguely knew that I wanted a career in the arts, but I didn't quite know exactly how to focus it. I couldn't imagine any job that I would like, and I didn't want to waste my parents' money. So I actually dropped out of college after my sophomore year, and I took a job in a convenience shop. And that year of working in that shop actually was like a course in life 101. It was one of the best things that I ever did, because I really wasn't motivated beforehand. And then afterwards, I went back to college majoring in cultural anthropology, which is a great background actually for gaming. You understand people. When I went back to college, I actually got straight A's for the first time in my life. I was really motivated after working in the shop. And later on, I went to graduate school in documentary filmmaking. But there's a lot of people that get into the industry without graduate degrees or even undergraduate degrees. It's really your portfolio that gets you work. It's the people that you know in your portfolio that get you your jobs. While I was in graduate school, I had an opportunity to intern. It was unpaid internship to work on a documentary about high school boys who were playing basketball. I know basketball is dear to Loyola's heart. And they had years of footage that they were trying to filter through, and they were looking for assistant editors. So I took on that assistant editor internship, but it wasn't so much my editing skills. I was a good editor, but it was also that I knew how to play basketball, that I had that opportunity to work on that internship on this documentary about high school basketball players. That film, Hoop Dreams, became a big box office hit. But while we were working on Hoop Dreams, nobody knew it was going to be that successful. So that's just a little story about how you never know what your path in life is going to, how that's going to open up opportunities for you. So in that case, it was just my basketball background. And then I want to talk a little bit too about work-life balance, because I know in the gaming industry or in any kind of creative field, there's a lot of competition, and it's easy to kind of be exploited and have really long work weeks. So it's important if you get into the industry to keep your head above water and see where the industry is going, and make sure that the jobs that you take are a good fit for you. I know Sajan was talking about that. Everybody was talking about make sure that your choices are something that follow your values and what you're interested in.
And as a creative, it's you also want to put in your best work. You want to develop your portfolio and show your best work. So it's easy to start working many, many hours. So, but keep in mind that if you aim for perfection, you may not have your product ready before a competitor ships a product, or you may miss opportunities to make friendships or go to lunch with people and things like that. So that's another thing to consider in work-life balance. Don't always try to aim for perfection, because that can put you down, can be distracting in other ways that you make opportunities in your career. As just a recent example, I always felt like I had to get better at my animation skills. And recently I use Adobe Creative Cloud, and you can download templates for the animation work in there, where the template would actually say, insert your video here, and it will put it into the context of an already created animation for you. So it's also, that's just an example of keep in mind where the industry is heading. Like, I didn't really need to work on my animation skills if there's templates available that can do the work for you. I'm not saying you should use templates, but you want to make sure your head is above water to see where the industry is going and see where your hard work is, if it's doing the best for your career and where you're heading. That's it for me. Back to you, George.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you very much for sharing those valuable, practical, real life examples from your life. At the end of it all, it's so important that our life and success is measured most importantly by good health, a wide and happy smile, good relationships. And quoting our beloved C.P. Varkey, for those who been under his stewardship, a golden heart. We have a poll that's put up in the Q&A box. So please take a few seconds and do give us your feedback. Now, as we come to the end of the panel discussion, we have a couple of key prizes to give out. So please do stay. As a precursor to the session, we had conducted a gameathon. The competition was to create a serious game idea that incorporated curriculum content. The experience was mind-boggling. We had 573 participants, over 11,500 views, and over 900 people voting. And we had over 30 phenomenal and creative ideas submitted from middle school onwards. Now I'd like to invite Mr. Shijo Sunny, Loyola's computer science teacher, to announce the winners.
Thank you, Mr. George. Well, good evening to all. Myself, Shijo Sunny, computer teacher at Loyola School. The panelists had a very tough time in selecting the finalists and the winners. Majority of the game ideas were very creative and fantastic. We are all indeed thankful to all the students who contributed the ideas. It is actually the game spirit that matters and not the winners alone. Before I announce the winners, I would like to place on record my sincere thanks on behalf of Loyola family to all the panelists, moderators, LOBA members, and all the well-wishers who contributed to the success of this Gameathon session. Special thanks goes to Father P.T. Joseph S.J., our principal, for organizing this event and giving me a chance to announce the winners. The talks are very informative. In fact, the panelists were discussing for the past 1 month, taking time out of their busy schedule. In fact, they are all CEOs, well-placed, working from America. We had discussion up to 11:30 overnight. Now, without further delay, I shall announce the winners. The Global Favorite Award winner is Aditya Kishore for his game Vedes. So congratulations, Aditya. Now, next Jury Award winner is going to Vishwa Kalyan Reddy for his game Corrupted. So congratulations, Vishwa. And the runner-up is Aditya M. Pillai for his game Jungle Survival. So congratulations once again to all the winners and participants. So cheer Loyola-san's matches. Off to Mr. George.
Thanks, Shijo. And congratulations to all the winners and all the participants. I'd like to share another fantastic news. Going beyond these mentoring sessions, some of our entrepreneurial colleagues are discussing different ways to guide and help. And that's an ongoing discussion. In this context, our panelists today and founder CEO of Aiton Inc., my good friend Thomas Vaidyan, has offered a summer internship to Dev Narayan and Mahadev in Vaidyan's offices in Trivandrum. Thanks, Vaidyan. Mahadev, do you want to comment and also perhaps give the overall vote of thanks for the evening?
Okay, so I'm really grateful to Mr. Vaidyan for giving me this opportunity, as it will help me a lot in my future. I would like to thank our principal, Father P.T. Joseph S.J., who has made such a huge event possible. Many others have made this technically possible, such as Mr. Shiju Sani, a computer teacher, as well as Mr. Robin and Mr. James Thomas, who has spent a lot of time supporting us, as well as Mr. Binoy Stephen, our tech guru, and Philippos Matthew, our communications pillar. Over to Dave.
Also, our gratitude to the Explore team, including Vaidyan, George, Sharjan, and Loba, who all made this possible. Once again, our very, very special thanks to Sarah for taking the time to join us today and share her insights. Before we close today's session, please know that we have our next panel on April 24th on making life and career choices, June 26th for management and consulting, July 24th for civil services, and August 28th for entrepreneurship.
Thank you all for joining.